Om Shri Sai Ram, I offer my most humble pranams at the lotus feet of beloved Swami. Dear Swami, respected elders, brothers and sisters, it's a really very, very, very special feeling to speak here, to be introduced here, because for the first time in my life, I've been introduced as a slim person, which makes me feel great. But jokes apart, what a beautiful moment it has been for me personally. This is my first trip to Sundaram, and it has been Ati Sundaram. Staying at Swami's residence, getting to know how Swami's love is through so many channels from whom so much of love has just flowed on me. I'm just overwhelmed and very grateful to Swami for this beautiful opportunity. Well, you know, they tried to give me a pleasant surprise, but that's how it is with Swami, you know. When nobody expected a garland to fall, it got cut. When everybody knew that it is imprinted on digital format and the garland has to get cut, it didn't get cut. That is the way Swami plays. His gifting is a blessing, his denial is also a blessing. And the faster we realize it, the better it'll be for us. The topic for me today is achieving Satya Sai through the organization, achieving one of the most beautiful goals possible in our lives, achieving Satya Sai. And Nimesh Pandya sir has waxed eloquent on this subject. You know, they often say that when somebody delivers a powerful speech, you get inspired to deliver a grander speech. When a batsman before you hits a century, you feel like going and hitting a century. That is only what they say. The truth is otherwise. When the batsman before you hits a century, you wonder what on earth, because my 100 is not going to count now. Only if I make 150 will it be useful. In the same manner, if the speaker before you thunders and enraptures the audience, you wonder, why me, Swami, why me? This is not the first time. It had happened once with Professor Anil Kumar, sir, where I had to speak after him and I said, Swami, why after him? Why not before him? But then what Professor Anil Kumar sir spoke that day, what Nimesh Pandya sir spoke today, it always reminds me that, you know what, when you say you're a speaker, you're a speaker. This is what had happened once in Mandir. There was this boy who was feeling, you know, very low because his speech was not well received. At the same time, there was also this boy who was feeling very proud and happy because he got thunderous applause for his speech. And when he was in that state of elation because he had delivered a thumping speech, Swami came and told him, you know, Swami came and asked, who was the speaker today? The boy raised his hand with joy. You know, when you have done something, you want to raise your hand. At the same time, if you have not done it well, who spoke today? No, you want to, if Swami changed the topic, it will be good. But here he had done well, so Swami asked, who was the speaker? He raised his hand. Then Swami came and told him something that is so awesome, you know. That was the time when before the bhajan, there would be music for 15 minutes. And as the flute notes began to fill the air, Swami asked, where is this music coming from? So the boy thought Swami was playing on the word speaker. He said, Swami, that is also from speaker. Swami said, no. Where is the music coming from? Swami, from speaker. Speaker, no, from where is the music coming? Swami, that is inside. No, that because it was in the bhajan hall. Swami, from inside. Swami said, remember, whether it's a speech or music, it always comes from inside. You are just a speaker. So that realization actually gives me a lot of courage and confidence because I'm just a speaker. The music and speech is coming from within. And with that gratitude to Swami, I embark on this challenging task. But I know it is not a challenge because the speaker is inside. I mean, the music is coming from inside. Now, first of all, you may ask, everybody has spoken about goals on how to achieve Swami, how to orient ourselves towards the goals of the Satya Sai organization. But first of all, why should I have a goal? Why can't I just lead my life happily? There's this story, you know, of a fisherman who is lying on the beach. He's just playing with the sand and looking at the sky, One person comes and tells, what is this? You're lazing around. Get up and start working. He says, why? What should I work? He says, don't you have any goals? He says, what goal should I have? Okay, for example, how many fish do you catch every day? Catch about 50 fish. Go make it 500 fish. Why? So that when you catch 500 fish, you know, you'll get more money. Maybe you can buy a bigger boat. What I'll do with bigger boat? You can catch 5,000 fish. And then more money, bigger boat. Bigger boat, ship. Then you'll have money, you'll have everything. And then you'll be happy. And then you can relax. What do you think I'm doing now? Just leave me. I don't want all these goals and all this. I'm relaxing and happy now. After slogging myself for so long, I'm going to get to relax. That anyway I'm doing now. Why should I have a goal in life? Why should I have a goal in life? This was a question that I asked myself when I was thinking about goals. You know, I was asked to give a talk on how to set our goals, how to achieve our goals. I was wondering, why should I have a goal first of all? If I don't need to have a goal, what is the use of setting a goal and achieving a goal? You know, that is when this beautiful thought came. If we see nature, you know, nature is the best teacher. If we see nature, you know, the cheetah is the fastest land mammal. The falcon has eyesight. It can see from kilometers away. Why? The peacock, so beautiful. When it dances, it's a majestic sight. Why have these animals been given these abilities and gifts? It's not for show off. It is not for the cheetah to race and say that, you know, I'm the best, fastest animal. It is necessary for the cheetah to run fast or else it will die out. It is necessary for the hawk to see 4 kilometers, otherwise it will die out. It is necessary for the peacock to dance, otherwise it won't get its peahen. So every magical ability of every single organism is given because it needs that. And in that perspective, man has been given one ability which no animal has. You know, it's amazing. Just see, no animal can think about the future. At best, the animal can think of its past. A rat will get trapped in a rat trap. And if it succeeds in escaping, it will remember that next time I better should not go near that rat trap. But you know what? Its son rat or daughter rat will not learn that lesson. It'll again go get caught in the trap. Each rat can learn from its own experience. It cannot learn from the experience of other rats. There will not be a young rat who says, you know, if I study the history of rats, 5,342,000 rats have got trapped in traps, and therefore I will not only learn, I will teach other rats that they should not go in the trap. Not possible at all, but man can. Because man has the ability not only to see the past, but also to plan and think for the future. No other animal has this ability of planning for the future. The lion will be sitting there. You can see some National Geographic videos. The lion will have hunted a deer. As it's eating the deer and it finishes, it's happy and it's resting in the shade. 5 more deer walk by. The lion, it doesn't bother only. If it was man, he would have hunted those 5 deer because next 5 months, savings, you can do, right? No animal plans because it can't think of the future. Only man has been given the ability to plan for the future. And just like the peacock was not given its tail for show off, the cheetah was not given its speed for show off, man was not given his ability to plan for show off. It was given because he needs. He needs to plan and set goals. And that is why we need to set goals, because we have been given the ability to set goals. Hey, just a minute. Nicely you're giving example of cheetah, wildcat and all and getting away with it. But you know, Swami says live in the present. What are you telling past, future and all that? Swami says, the present is a seed which has come from the tree of the past, which contains the tree of the future. Swami says, live in the present. When he says that, it means we have to live in the present, learning the lessons of the past, building up for a good future. So planning is very much there. You know, look at this. Imagine a march past parade is going on. It's a sports meet. We had a little bit of those clippings in the morning. Sports meet parade is going on, march past. As the squads come marching by, you're standing on the ground and you're seeing. You can see about this much. One squad you can see. whether they're doing it correctly or wrong. Now imagine Swami. Swami is sitting on Shanti Vedika. He can see the entire squad. That's why everyone is told, you know, don't try to march very well only when you're near Shanti Vedika. From the time you start till the time you finish, you have to march well. Because I may not see you, the PT instructor may not see you, but Swami can see you. Now imagine Swami sitting at a great height. That is how God is, at a height. We are on the floor, so we see only the present. I don't know what is the past. I don't know what is the future. I can see only this much. Now imagine you are on the floor watching the march past. Swami is on the 20th floor watching the march past. And you tell, Swami, wow, this squad is so superb. Swami will tell, which squad? Because, dear one, I can see all the squads. I can see 45 squads. Which squad are you talking about? This one, Swami, right in front of me. Are you right in front of me? I've got 45 squads. See, when we reach that level, we can live in the present. Because it is the omnipresent. There's no past, there's no future. It is just the omnipresent. But until we get to that level, let us learn from the past and let us plan for the future without using convenient philosophy of shifting gears between Dvaita and Advaita as per our convenience. So, if we feel we are in the Dvaita world, if we feel that we want happiness more than and we want to avoid sorrow, then we definitely need to think of the past and plan for the future. So, is it convincing enough that we need to make some plans and have some goals? Okay. Now, what is the best goal that we can? What is the best goal that we can plan for? Instinctively, we know Swami. Yes. What do you want from Swami? Swami, I want you. You know, this was what we were trained. If Swami asks, Em Kavali, Swami, Mire Kavali. What do you want, Swami? We want you. Whether you understand it or not, ask for Swami. What does it mean when we ask for Swami? I should just imagine it this way. Imagine Swami says, Bangaru, what do you want? Swami, I want you. Want me? Come. Sit. How are you feeling? Swami, I'm feeling so happy. You're sure you want only me and nothing else? Nothing else, Swami. Just to be at your lotus feet. This is Brahmanandam, Paramasukadam, Kevalam Jnanamurtim. Dvandvatitam goes on. Yes. Chala Santosham. Sit. We sit. Swami, I'll do Padaseva. Do. Abba. Bliss divine. Imagine sitting at the lotus feet of the Lord. You've got everything now. 4 hours pass. We want a tea break. Swami, feeling a little hungry, little thirsty. Huh? What happened? Don't want me? I want you, Swami. I'll just have tea and come back. If you want me, no tea. Okay, Swami. You think? My devotion is, I don't want tea. Fine, you will refuse the input. What about the output? 5 hours later, when, you know, somebody says, when man calls, nobody listens. When God calls, few people listen. When nature calls, nobody can refuse, you know. So, at that time, if Swami asks you, would you like to answer that call or would you want God? What is our priority and preference has changed. Does it mean that we really don't want Swami? No. It just means we don't know what it means by saying that we want God, we want Swami. Without knowing what it means, we are just taught. And that is good as long as we are children on the spiritual field. That is why even Swami used to appreciate it when children say, you know. He come to primary school children and say, where did you come from, boy? Swami, from you. Chala Santosham. See that little boy? He says he came from Swami. What a good boy. You know, Swami is so proud. Next to that, the institute boy is sitting. Nice answer. Okay. Boy, kidhar se aya? Swami, from you, Swami. Kidhar se aya? Swami, from you, Swami. Hey, Norm, shut up. Where did you come? Swami, from Bombay, Swami. Over. All the philosophy of having come from Swami, over. Because Swami knows that the child need not know why 2 into 2 is 4. You just mug it up now. 2 into 2 is 4, 2 3 are 6, 2 4 are 8. But when you reach 10th grade and they ask why 2 3 are 6, I don't know, 2 3 are 6. No, you better know. So also, as children in the field of spirituality, when we say, I want Swami, nothing else, understood. But do you know what it means when you say you want Swami? Swami says there's a test of 3 zeros you should subject yourself to. No, Swami says, When you're asking for the greatest gift, do you think freely I'll give it? You see that with Swami. You ask him for, Swami, health, he'll give off. Wealth, he'll give off. Tell Swami, I want you. He won't even look at you. You'll see people come by the side, ask for something, get and go off. But you'll sit there for 10 years asking for the greatest, he won't give you at all. And then, imagine, if you are, I went to the fact saying that Swami doesn't give what you ask for the ultimate, because do you know what it means to ask for the ultimate? Now imagine Swami says, I take away all your wealth. You were prosperous and happy. Now you don't have a cowrie pie. You have to beg. And every rupee you have to wonder where it will come from. At that time, no, Swami will ask, do you want money or do you want me? Money or me? No, Swami, I don't want money. I want you. Then the next zero. Take away all your friends and relations. Not by death. Possibly by death. Possibly by misunderstanding. Whatever. All are gone. You are lonely, alone in this world. Because Swami wants to know whether you really want Swami. Now see, that situation was different. Now do you want your friend and family back or do you want me? Swami is very possessive. Huh? Very, very possessive. And he's possessive because when he gives himself in such a manner that we don't need anything in life. And he'll ask. It's not yet over, you know. He asks. And you say, no, Swami, want you. It's not the time for applause, because next he takes away something that is dearest to each one of us. Our self-respect. Self-respect is gone. Forget no family, no friends, forget no money. People say that you're a criminal. You are not. People accuse you wrongly. Your self-respect is down in the drains. And Swami will tell, is your self-respect dear to you or am I dear to you? And at that time, if we can say, Swami, I don't care for my self-respect. You matter for me. Then it's time for applause. That is the time we can applaud for ourselves, because then we would have got the greatest gift of our lives, which is Swami. That is what is meant by having Swami as our goal. Having Swami as our goal. You know, a disciple went to a guru and he said, Guru, I just want only Swami. Forget it. I want only God. I want only God, but why am I not getting it? I'm doing everything as you have prescribed. Mantra, bhajan, everything I'm doing. Guru says, okay, I will give you. I will give you a secret by which you will get to see God tomorrow. Go, tomorrow have bath, be ready, in the river I'll come. So this disciple excited, he won't get sleep at night. You know, and Swami used to go to Kodaikanal, if he has picked up some students, how exciting it would be. They would not get sleep 2-3 nights. That kind of excitement, he goes, he has his bath, ablutions, everything ready, he's waiting for the guru to come. The guru comes, and as he's standing in the river, the guru asks, are you ready? He says, yes, Guru, I'm ready for the mantra. He says, turn around. He turns around. And he's expecting some light to come. Instead, a heavy hand of the guru lands on his head and pushes him into the water. And the guru is so strong that he's struggling. He's not able to take breath in the water. He's fighting. He's just not able to release himself from the guru's grasp. And he's thinking, oh my God, I said I wanted to meet God, not this way. You know, don't send me to God this way. I want to meet him face to face on earth. He fights, just not able to break the hold of the guru. And now he realizes that I'm going to die. If I don't break free now, I'm going to die. Oh my God, I don't want to die. And suddenly he gets a surge of strength. He throws. The guru goes flying. And he comes out. Oh God, my lungs burned. Because I didn't need that much air. I was not in need of air like that guy. But you know, when he came out, guru asks, what did you feel? What do you mean, what did I feel? You killed me. You are my master or what? You were supposed to give me salvation. Take me across the ocean, Bhavasagara, not drown me in it. You are trying to kill me. The guru says, no, tell me what happened. Didn't you see? I was struggling. I was about to lose my life. Why? Because I didn't have air. And then what happened? I was not able to come out also because you're holding me down. But you came out in the end. When I was sure I'm going to die, I don't know from where the strength came. I just broke, I came. God's grace that I survived. Then the guru says, dear one, the way you wanted air, if you want God, just like you got strength to break my hands and come out and get air, you will be given the strength to break out and get God. But do we want God that desperately? That badly do we need God that we feel, Swami, without you I'll die, Swami. Swami, you are my everything. Are we in that state? That was the kind of state Mirabai went into. That was the kind of state Surdas went into. Poison could not kill Mirabai. But she felt, I am dead without Krishna. That is the beauty of God, you see. Poison couldn't touch Mirabai. Poison didn't kill her. Lack of Krishna is killing her. Do we need Swami in such a manner? Now, you may tell, okay, you are fast forwarding too much on the heart front. Wait, let's think logically. Why are you dying so desperately for Swami? Cool. Why you want to lose money, friends, relationship, everything and then die and cry and do all that? And what? Why you want to go behind God? Choose other goals. No, it's easier to get. In fact, if you ask Swami, as I said, for either money or relationship or career, you will be easily given that. It'll be granted to you. Why ask for something that he will do kanjusi about and not give easily? Because, dear brothers and sisters, again, you know, I'll take you back when Swami one day came walking out. This is a common occurrence that used to happen. He would come and tell, Aaj Chief Minister aaya hai, Swami will tell. Prime Minister has come. Chief Minister has come. Some other day he'll come and tell, Big businessman, bahut paisa hai, he has come. Some other day he'll come, tell, no, Sachin Tendulkar aaya hai. He need not tell, we already know. And half of us have already run for autographs. But Swami will come and tell. And you know, children that we were in those days, we used to think that, you know, Swami is also coming and telling, see how famous I am. Politicians are coming, stars are coming. We used to feel that Swami is able to be free with only his students. So he's coming and boasting in front of us. You know, he can't go and tell others, no. But you can be yourself with your people. So we used to feel very special. See, we are special people. See, Swami tells us don't boast and all. But he also has that, you know, little urge to boast. And where he can boast, if not in front of us, that is why he is boasting. That was our foolishness. That was how we used to think. Now, today we realize it was a beautiful and powerful message that Swami was thumping into us. Look at that guy. He is the most powerful guy in the state. He is the most powerful guy in the nation. He's come here in front of me stretching his hand. Look at that guy, he's the most popular guy. Everybody loves him. He has come to me stretching out his hand. Look at that guy, he's the richest guy. He's got so much money. He has come to me stretching out his hand. And you want to go run behind that? When I am there here for you? Such a message it is. Because dear ones, at the end of all that, you know what they will do? They'll come to me. I've got you directly to me. Why do you want to go through that cycle? This is what Swami said when he materialized the medallion with the India map on it and all the centers, and you know, it was in Sanskrit and the whole future was there. We are all very interested. That's why we go to Nadi, Nostradamus and all that. We have predictors. During World Cup, we make octopuses and elephants predict. Anything that predicts becomes valuable. We are so eager to know. And so that time also the boys were eager to know what was written on it. If you hear that discourse, you will see Swami is saying, why do you run behind that when the one who has created that is here offering? That is how we are. If Swami should give me one ring, Swami should give a chain. Chain less preference, ring more preference. Why? Because when I do Sairam, everybody can see. Chain is inside. Then only no value. Sairam. Oh, ring. Swami gave a? Sometimes Swami will not give ring, you know, that green emerald ring Swami won't give. We'll only get one made and wear. They'll tell, oh. Many people will silently assume it is Swami. Some people, you know, spoil sports, who want to ruin our fun, will ask, Swami gave that ring, and now it's gone, because you know you have made it. The intelligent answer. Oh, this ring Swami did not give. As if you have got one ring somewhere secret that Swami has given. Now everything, as I said, are we doing it for show, or is it because we can't live without that? Speaking about wealth, I was reminded of Ryoko Hira, sir. He's heading the Sai organization in Japan. He's been quoted as the richest Indian in Japan. I'll give you a small idea of his wealth through this incident. In 1991, when Swami wanted to build the hospital, Ryoko Hira sir, along with Indulal Shah sir, Justice P.N. Bhagwati sir, and Dr. Safaya sir, they went and said, Swami, we want to do like how the squirrel served Rama while building the bridge. We also want to serve you, Swami. So their plan was they will go on a world tour and sensitize everybody about Swami's project. Hira sir was saying that he wanted to, you know, speak his heart out to all the charitable people in the world and say, you know, this is the best place to contribute your money. He had an audience of 500 odd in the Wimbledon Theatre in London. And he was speaking there and he said, after I completed my speech, for the first time in my life, I got a standing ovation. Everybody stood up and clapped. He's saying the thrill I felt on stage there evaporated 5 minutes later, because when it came to donating money, there was nothing. We are very generous in our applause, but are we generous in what we give? And he was so disappointed. He felt, I have let Swami down. So you know what he did? He went and discussed with his wife. He said, let us sell our house in Tokyo and give that money to Swami. So you and me sell our house and give it to Swami. We can donate 40 lakhs, 50 lakhs. When he got it evaluated in 1991, his house was worth $20 million. And when he came to Swami, what happened, I will hold for suspense for 2 minutes, because I want to ask this question as to what made Hira sir just decide in a moment that I will give $20 million to Swami. Because in his heart, he knew that Swami is worth much more. And we give up Swami for far less. When it comes to either relationships or money or anything, for far less we give up. People who have reached the pinnacle, they come and say, Swami, take this, but just want to be at your lotus feet. Give us this opportunity to serve. You know what Swami told him? Swami said, hey, Bangaru, patted him. I never asked for this. Which mother will like the child to live in a rented house? Take it back. Because brothers and sisters, Swami will not be happy with the cheap gifts of our money and relationship and this. He wants the greatest gift of our love. That is what we also seek from him, the greatest gift. So let us also not be satisfied with the cheap things. You know, a mother, if the child starts crying, what the mother does? She'll get a rattle. Kitty, 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 kitty. If it smiles, give the rattle and walk off. Again, she'll start cooking. Again, the child will cry, she'll get a teddy. She'll get something. The child should just cry like hell. Then what the mother does? Just drops whatever she's doing, picks up the baby and puts it to her bosom. As children of mother Sai, that is what we have to do. Let us not be satisfied with rattles and dolls that he gives us. Because he'll give it, because he'll, what do you want? She said, no, I want that milk of divine love, Swami, nothing else. Then he will put us to his bosom. And therefore, without doubt, the best goal to have in life is Swami. Is Swami. You know, Swami had once told a student, why people seek money? Because if you ask 3 times why this, why this, why this, you'll get to know. Basically, because you think it'll make you happy. Why you want money? Because I want to build my own house. Why do you want to build your own house? Because then I need not depend on others. I can live safely. Why you want to live independent and safely? Because then I can be happy and contented. So ultimately you want money because you want to be happy. Same thing with relationship. I want this girl or I want this boy. Why? Because then we'll be in harmony, because it'll be happy. Swami says, why are you trying to use your little intelligence there? If you want happiness, ask for happiness. Why do you want to tell, I want money which will make me happy. I want a position which will make me happy. Why? I will do the thinking. No. You just ask what you want. Because my Bangaru, happiness is only in union with God. Nowhere else you'll get it. Nowhere else you'll get it. See the portico. Who all have come? Prime Minister has come. Chief Minister has come. Now see the difference when we see Swami saying that. It is not a boast. It is a great lesson for all of us. And Swami says, see, robe no pocket. In his robe no pocket. He owns nothing. Doesn't have a bank account. People used to say, Swami is having this much, this much, this much. Swami must be laughing at them, telling, what you're telling, 150 crores, that is nothing, that is not even this much. What I have is infinite. There was this guru, Bahaduri Mahashay. He had great family wealth. And once his family passed away, you know what he did? He just gave off everything and became a sannyasi. Later he became a guru. A guru whom even Paramahamsa Yogananda went and met. So some of his disciples used to tell him, Guru, you are a great Tyagi. What a Mahan Tyagi you are. You know, you gave up such great family wealth for sannyasa. He would laugh and say, you are reversing the case. You know, I gave up a few paltry rupees for a cosmic empire of infinite bliss. You are all the great Tyagis. You are giving up that empire for a few rupees and trinkets. I salute to you. You are the Tyagis. I am not a Tyagi. I am a selfish person who has sought the greatest. And so therefore, one half of the talk is complete with, we should seek Swami. We should achieving Swami. What do we mean by now achieving Swami? We do this small test in the classroom actually to all the awareness class students. Now they are told, from the morning till night, how many people help you in your job, help you, just list them down. When you usually list them down, there'll be about 15-20 people. Father and mother or wife, or you know, because they're all students, there'll be no wife. It'll all be father, mother. If you're in the hostel, then teacher, some 15-20 people. But if we do this thing ourselves, we realize that it's something much more. You know, in the morning when we go, as I said, a call that you cannot refuse. You go and open the tap, there is water coming. What a miracle. What do you mean it's a miracle? It's a miracle because there is the watchman who is pumping the water into the tank. There is a corporation that is sending the water into the basement. So that when I go, I can have water. I may be a great software engineer, aeronautical engineer. I may be a scientist. I may be a judge, anything. If this call is not answered, nothing I can do properly. It'll trouble me throughout the day. It may trouble even others around me. Such is the kind of seva that watchman is doing, which I don't even recognize. The newspaper that comes to my doorstep. In Puttaparthi, there was a strike of all the workers, laborers, sweepers. They said, we want more salary and went on strike. So when I was walking towards the studio, I heard them shouting slogans. I said, okay, yeah, some nuisance. But in 2 days, I realized what a thing it is. Puttaparthi was resembling a rubbish heap. Couldn't walk on the road. I felt I might get some infection if I walk on the road. I feared for my dear life. And when I say I am speaking on behalf of all the citizens of Puttaparthi. When that sweeper doesn't do his job properly, I can't do my job properly. Just for me to do my job properly, I need so many of them to do their job properly. What is the relation between that municipal water guy and me? He doesn't know me, he may not meet me in his lifetime. But thank you, guy. Because if you don't do it, no, I can't do my job properly. When we do like this and go in detail, we realize that for us to do our jobs properly, at least 120 people are involved. Now, shouldn't I do something so that at least 120 people are benefited? How can I think of myself? Well, that is that fellow's karma. I am doing the job, it's my salary. Why I should give to anybody? Why I should do seva? It's your salary, boss, but you know, water is coming in your house. You can't go to your office if there's no water at your house. This is only at the level of society. And Swami in his discourse says, the sun is giving sunlight. If sun doesn't give you sunlight, what you'll do your work in office? What use is your money? It happened during the Kuwait war. There's a person from Chennai who had to go through that harrowing experience, who came out unscathed because of Swami's love, where during the Kuwait war, he saw currency notes by thousands being given, told, give me 1 pound of bread. No. Get out. Money can't buy bread. We are giving value to money. Money doesn't give value to us. So too, what about the sunlight, the water, the air, everything that God has given? Shouldn't we do our bit to enhance all this? When we need so many people to do their job right so that we can benefit, shouldn't we do our job right so that everybody can benefit? And I feel that is one way of achieving Swami, doing our jobs perfectly. In office, in the organization, whatever is the role given to us, if I'm a bhajan singer, I will do it perfectly. If I'm going to sweep, I will sweep it like the best sweeper in the world. That's it. People may ask, why should I do seva? Because if we don't do seva, the society will collapse. Swami says, Vyashti, Samashti, Srushti, Parameshti. Vyashti is individual, Samashti is society, Srushti is creation, and Parameshti is God. Swami says, individual is a part of society, society is a part of nature, nature is a part of God, just like finger is a part of the palm, palm is a part of the hand, hand is a part of the body. The finger can't tell, I am healthy, I don't care for the body. Hey, you little finger, really it's the little finger. If the body dies, you are going to die within 2 days, no matter how healthy you are. If the society collapses, we are going to collapse, no matter how rich, how prosperous we are. If nature collapses, we are going to collapse, no matter how rich, how prosperous we are. Simple as that. And that is why people do amputation, cut the leg to save the body. No problem if the leg goes. Because if the body goes, everybody dies. And so you see, sacrifice is not something that is done as an extra effort. It is a natural thing. We learn it from the human body. That is why Swami says proper study of mankind is man. Study man, you will understand how mankind should be. Because the whole of mankind is one giant organism. All of us are a parts of that Purusha. Sahasra Shirasha Purusha, Sahasraksha Sahasrapad. So therefore, when we say we have to serve Swami, it actually means we have to serve the society. We have to serve the nature. It's inbuilt. Now the final question, why achieve Swami and serve Swami through the organization? Why I should not do it on my own? Why should I join the organization? When the hostel was inaugurated and a hostel system of education was brought in, you know. But before this, let me tell one nice story. Because I feel if 10 minutes of solid hammer comes, one story should come, otherwise people will not forgive me. One excuse that may come is, you know, that person has got money, that person has got energy, I'm a handicap, I don't have money. Why I should, how I can help? How can I serve? You know, Swami encouraged everybody to do something. Sacrifice, because Tyage Naike Amritatva Manushu. You attain the ultimate only through sacrifice. And so it doesn't matter how poor you are, how weak you are, you have to do. That is why you will see in the canteen, very elderly people serving water. Something at least you do. You know, this happened when the same super specialty hospital came into existence at Puttaparthi. There was this person being considered for the job of a cook. You know, there's a dietetics department, so he had to join as a cook. And he had been trained and he had a lot of experience. And he was expecting a salary of around 1,500 rupees. For his expertise and for his experience. Swami said, tell him I'll offer 300 rupees. One fifth. When this was told to him, he was in serious thought. He could go and join a 3-star or 5-star hotel, make 1,500. But here, he's getting to join Swami's organization, Swami's hospital, but only 300 rupees. Then Swami also sent words, told, tell him, that Swami will take care of him. When this was told, he said, yes, I will join for 300. He joined for 300. A few years back, he retired from service also. And when he retired, he had tears of joy. You know what he said? He said, sir, I have 2 daughters and 1 son. Son has built his own house. My 2 daughters are married into good families. I have built my own house and I have a savings. I don't want anything. Swami has given everything. I didn't sacrifice anything for Swami. Because you know when Swami says, I'll give you everything, why do you save money? Because your daughter's wedding will come. Because some health issue will come. When a boy's mother had cancer, Swami said, get. He's serving here, get all the equipment needed in the super specialty. And cancer equipment was brought. When this cook's daughter's marriage came, Swami gave him one white cover. Silk saris, silk dhotis, mangal sutra, gold jewels, cash. Why you want to save money? When you need, I will give. Because Because you know, you are worth 1,500 rupees, but you have sacrificed 1,200. You are offering it to society, to nature, to God. It becomes my responsibility. I will take care of you. Let me see what will touch you. And he said, even if I had joined a 5-star job, I wouldn't have been in this position that I am today. Don't ask me how it happened, but it happened. That is why Swami will say, because you know, the joy of giving is something that is ultimate. In fact, during Gram Seva, Swami will tell, that's why I will get the food, I will get the trucks, everything. You just go and give. You just go and give, because giving is an addiction. You try it. You say smoking is an addiction, drinking is an addiction. Try giving. Once you give, you just don't want to receive. You just want to give. Because the joy is so much. What else you want in life? You want joy, right? Just try giving. It's an addiction. And that is what Swami hooks us onto when he sends us for Gram Seva. When he sends us for Seva. He tells Seva is an addiction that will give you bliss. You may think it, you're losing money, you're losing energy. You just go and see what fulfillment it'll give you in life. A kind of fulfillment that nothing else will give. So coming back now to what I was saying, the story I have told you, nice story. Awesome story. When Swami had the hostel inaugurated, he had a hostel schedule drawn up, you know, of morning, this time should be Suprabhatam. In fact, there was some kind of Swami, Jogarao sir, who was there, said, Swami, Brahma Muhurtam, you only said 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock should be Suprabhatam. Just imagine if Swami had listened to Jogarao sir, instead of 5:30 today morning, every morning at 4, you would have to do Suprabhatam. There were a few people who said, Swami, not so much, Swami, not 4 o'clock. Swami said, then when? Swami, around 6:30. Hey, no, 6:30 too late. As a via media, they came to 5 o'clock, 5:30, okay, fix. Jogarao, 4 o'clock too early. Hey, 7 o'clock too late. Such love Swami has prepared that schedule, you know. Worldwide today at 5:30 we do Suprabhatam. Thanks to whoever, otherwise 4 o'clock imagine. Many of us don't sleep till then. Getting up at 4 o'clock. But then Swami, then after making the whole schedule, Swami said, my boys need not do any sadhana. Let them just follow the hostel schedule, it's enough. That same Swami has given us this beautiful organization and said, you just do this, it's enough. It's a shortcut. Why can't we just, it's so easy. That is why come to the organization. There's a 9-point code of conduct. You just follow it. It's been given by Swami, not by anybody. It's not come out of study circle or it has not come out of discussions. It has been dictated by Swami and said, do this, it's enough. Just imagine, why you want to do sadhana? Why you want to do seva? I want to please Swami. Swami saying, Are Baba, I have told you what to do. Do it. No. This 9-point you do. Why you want to do something else? No, I want to go to Himalayas and meditate. Are, no need. I am telling you what I like. It's like going to a restaurant and saying, I like gobi manchurian, get me. No, you must try mushroom, it's great. Are, I want gobi manchurian. You want to make me happy? Same way. Swami saying, you want to make me happy, I'm telling you what to do. Now, I'll conclude with the 9-point code of conduct, because there's something very, very interesting in this. This was again raised by Nimesh Pandya sir. He was saying, every bhajan singer must serve. Every person, every sevadal must read Swami's literature. Because this is one often a problem that comes to us, where we wonder, no, which is better? Karma is better or bhakti is better or jnana is better? No, bhajan singing, I don't do. You know, I am a karma margi. They simply keep singing. Movie club, some song club it is. I do hard work. I sweep the floors. I lift the dung. I help the old people. I do medical camps. Seva is what pleases Swami. Don't you know hands that help are holier than lips that pray? Wow, nice. You know, we use Swami's quotations as and when we want, how we want it. But you know, in one discourse, Swami has said, karma marga is like primary school. Bhakti marga is higher secondary school. Jnana marga is university. Understood? So, you primary school fellows, you go and do all that. I'm going to meditate and read. I'm jnana margi. Brother Sai Prakash is here. When they had made an exhibition, he had made an exhibit where a bullock cart was there, which was named Karma Marga. A motor car was there, which was Bhakti Marga. And an aeroplane, Jnana Marga. And when Swami saw, he said, Swami, this is how it is. Karma Marga means you can go. You can go, if you want to reach Amsterdam, it'll take you 8 months. In car, if you want to go, it'll take you maybe 8 days. But flight, 8 hours it'll take you. Swami said, that is correct. But remember, if you fall from the flight, no chance of survival. You fall from the car, injury. Fall from the bullock cart, nothing will happen. Safe. So therefore, Jnana Marga is not so good. So now, which is the correct Marga to take up? The mistake that we do, which Swami has so beautifully pointed out, is we think there are three separate roads. It is like a single road with tar and mud and everything. You can't go only on the tar, you are going on the mud also. You know, Swami says, it is like, our life is like a three-wheeler, an auto rickshaw. And each of the wheels is one of each of the margas. Karma, bhakti and jnana. Now, can you go on a unicycle? You need all the three wheels. But it is left to your choice. If you like bhakti, put bhakti as your front wheel. Karma and jnana back wheels. If you like doing seva, put karma as your front wheel. Bhakti and jnana back wheels. But remove any one wheel, it will collapse. So think of it. Adi Shankaracharya, what was he? Jnana Margi, undoubtedly, Advaitin. But how many mudakaratamodakam sadavimu? You know who composed it? Adi Shankaracharya. Eh? What was he doing in bhakti? Can you say Adi Shankaracharya didn't have bhakti? Can you say Mother Teresa didn't have jnana, didn't have wisdom? It's there in the 9-point code of action, you know. This is so exciting, you know, without us knowing it is inbuilt. Now what I'll do is I'll read out each of the 9 points. You can just say whether it's karma, bhakti or jnana. Daily meditation and prayer, bhakti. Devotional singing with family members, bhakti. Participation in Sai spiritual education by children, jnana. Participation in community service of the organization, karma. Attendance of devotional meetings, bhakti. Study of literature, jnana. Soft loving speech, karma. Avoidance of talking ill of others, especially in their absence, karma. Practicing sealing on desires to eliminate wastage, karma. Now once you classify this, look at it. 4 karma, 3 bhakti, 2 jnana. Lot of karma, little of bhakti, even little of jnana. When we have 9 hours every day, spend 4 hours in karma, 3 hours in bhakti, 2 hours in jnana. That's what it is, right? The hour and the clock also. Second hand moves a lot, minute hand little less, hour hand very little. So don't for 9 hours read Sathya Sai Speaks, you will sleep. I'm really saying, sleep off. Because, you know, it'll just be empty words and statements unless the experience hits you. Go and do seva and read what Swami has said about seva. You'll just get tears of joy and you won't feel like speaking anything at all. Because you'll tell Swami, it is so true, it is so true. Otherwise, we just remain speakers. And in that bhakti, the bhajan comes automatically. It comes so beautiful. All three are just one. So we cannot say that I am a bhajan singer and I won't do seva. I am a sevadal and I won't do this. We have to have all the three components. And that is why Swami gave the 9-point code of conduct. Otherwise, he could have given a 2.5 point or 1 point. He could have just told, just meditate and get salvation. No. All are needed. All are needed to build on each other because it's a three-wheeler. According to your choice, you put your front wheel. But the other two wheels have to be there. Just like Shankaracharya had front wheel as jnana, but had bhakti and karma as the back wheel. How much service Shankaracharya did? How much of devotional compositions he has given? How much raptures of devotion he has gone into? So everything is important. So when we try to achieve Swami, we achieve Swami because it is the greatest goal that we can achieve in life. And the best possible manner we can achieve Swami is through the organization because Swami has given that. And when we are trying to do that through the three paths of bhakti, karma and jnana, let us not say this is important or that is important. Let us stick on. And if I am allowed 5 more minutes, yes, yes, thank you, thank you. I will conclude with a personal experience because this again has a very, very powerful message. Again, another message that Nimesh Pandya sir told us. You know, he was saying that how, you know, Krishna doesn't work, let's go to Shiva. Shiva doesn't work, Shirdi Baba. Mother is very kind. Swami tells the Chinnakatha about that, you know. He says there was this boy who went to his guru and said, Guru, I want to worship an idol, help me, I want to worship God. He gives him Shiva. This fellow does puja for Shiva for 2 months, nothing happens. He goes and tells Guru, Shiva is a little useless. He only doesn't have enough body, he'll give me what I want. Give me some other god. Krishna you try. Krishna, you know. He's got Lakshmi at his feet. So much so that people forget that Lakshmi is at his feet. They go directly to Lakshmi. They don't know that if they get Vishnu, Lakshmi comes free. Correct, no? She has to be there to press his feet. Buy one, get one free offer it is. But we forget Narayana and go for Lakshmi. And Lakshmi will never leave Narayana. You tell Narayana, I don't want you, I want Lakshmi. Lakshmi will tell, pack off, I won't come. You tell, pack off Lakshmi, I don't want, come Narayana. Lakshmi will tell, I'll come. Has to follow. So he gives, anyway, he gives Krishna. He tries Krishna, Krishna also doesn't work. Goes and tells Guru, give some really powerful god, I'm doing everything, you know, Aarti, Agarbatti, meditation, everything I'm doing, not working. So you take mother. Mother, no, melts. Okay, he gets mother, he's doing. He decides to give mother also 1 month time to respond. Something suddenly happens on the 15th day. He lights Agarbatti and he's sitting. There's a breeze. And in that breeze, that Agarbatti is going to Shiva idol, which is neglected and kept on top there. He says, hey you Shiva, you didn't give me anything, you're smelling my Agarbatti. So he says, wait. He goes, gets a cloth and ties it around Shiva's nose. So you don't, that Agarbatti is for mother, not for you. And the minute he ties, Shiva appears there. He says, oh, sorry, hey, Shiva, Shiva says, child, what do you want? He says, forget what I want. Why are you doing like this? Strange god you are. What happened? No, I was worshipping you, giving you prasadam, agarbatti, everything. You didn't come. Now I tie your nose and you're coming. And Shiva says, child, you know, today for the first time, you believed that I was existent here. Till now you felt you are giving something to the stone. For the first time you felt that, hey, this Shiva, cunning fellow, is simply smelling of my agarbatti without giving anything. You believed that I was a breathing entity here, and therefore what you believe is what I show myself. What we believe is what we will see in front of our eyes. In front of a mirror, if you stand and tell, I want glass of water, what will the mirror show? It'll show a glass of water. You stand and tell, I don't want iPhone. Who will tell that? Anyway, suppose you tell, I don't want iPhone. The mirror will still show iPhone. It doesn't matter what you want, what you don't want. What you hold is what you get. And when you hold in your heart that it is, he's alive. So it doesn't matter whether you worship Shiva, Krishna, Jesus, Buddha, Rama, nothing. Hold on and have the faith. And the incident I wanted to narrate was on the day of Ashadi Ekadashi, 2008. Nimesh Pandya sir will remember that year they had got cutouts of many Maharashtrian saints. They were decorated behind Swami. And as Swami was going down the stage to pose for group photographs, I was sitting there with the camera. Swami just asked me, Entra, Guru Alto Sarati Kurchunnava. He asked, you're sitting with all your gurus there. I saw Eknath, Tukaram, all Gajanan Maharaj, all the who's who of saints from Maharashtra, Dhyaneshwar, Jnaneshwar. I went and said, yes, Swami. And as Swami was going on, suddenly I realized, I ran back to Swami and I said, Swami, I'm sitting with saints, not gurus, Swami, because really only you are my guru, Swami. And Swami felt so happy that day. It was Ashadi Ekadashi. He went, he posed for photographs with them. 3 days later, as every year it happens, it was Guru Purnima. And at the end of the Guru Purnima program, when Swami was blessing the prasadam, he takes one laddu and he throws. And the boy sitting in the front goes and picks up. He takes another laddu and he throws, the boy picks up. Another boy goes and picks up. Then he picks up a third and he points and says, no, you. I'm sitting in the third row. So I ask me, Swami says, yes. And instead of throwing it front, he throws it near his feet. So I climb up the stage to go and take the laddu. And Swami tells, take namaskar. So I'm taking namaskar, Swami says, you told me, no, I'm your guru. You know, so sweet. He remembered. And he was, I really feel there's nothing special about me in that. It's all Swami's speciality. But you know, it was a very powerful message Swami was giving. You know, Swami has never told, he never told a Shirdi Sai devotee, believe me. What did he do? He gave him darshan as Shirdi Sai. He never told a Shiva devotee, come and believe me. He gave him darshan as Shiva. That is what happened to the first priest of Puttaparthi, Sheshagiri Rao. He said, I don't want to come, he's a fake, I'm a Shiva devotee. But when he came to Puttaparthi as an escort with his wife and daughter, he collapsed unconscious on the Chitravati bed. Swami said he won't come back to consciousness for 2 days, keep him in. After 2 days, Swami created Vibhuti and revived him. And you know what he said? He said, I saw my Shiva. And the person who said, I'm coming only for one day as escort, he said to his wife and daughter, you may leave Puttaparthi. I am never in my life going to leave Puttaparthi, for I have found my Shiva here. And he stayed throughout his life in Puttaparthi. So Swami has never, never, never encouraged anyone to change whom they seek. So when we have chosen Swami as our guru, our God, why do we want to seek from others? There is that temptation, you know. It happened even when we went to Himalayas, there were some people who went and asked other, Guruji, now you know Swami is gone, what we should do? That person who was calling himself as Kedar Baba, when this person asked, Baba is not there now, what we should do? He said, Murkh, fool, he said. Kya shabd bhagwan hota, kya roop bhagwan hota hai? He asked. Is form God? Shabd bhagwan hota hai. He said, the word is God and Swami's word will live forever. Don't seek from me. The guru is telling, don't seek from me, you seek your guru. Why do we run to others? I'll conclude with this final analogy of a well being dug, you know. It's often told, dig. When you want to dig, dig at one spot. Don't dig at 10 spots. When you dig deep enough, anywhere you dig, you will hit water. Instead of that, you dig 5 spots, you won't get water. When this analogy was told to me in the class, one of us, you know, got up and asked the teacher, sir, what if, just imagine, what if I'm digging at one spot only, as you say, but I dug and dug and dug and dug and went full deep inside, and still I didn't get water, then what I'll do, sir? What I'll do? Is it not better to dig at least 2 wells? You know, the teacher dropped the chalk. He came. He was speaking with a wealth of experience, because this is a teacher who has gone through tremendous hardships in life. And he was saying, children, this is a secret I'll tell you. Believe me, when you stick to one well and keep digging deep, 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 if you don't find water below, God will shower water from above. Don't worry. You will get water. Just persevere and dig. Just persevere and dig at the same spot. All of us have been privileged and blessed to have been given Swami in our lives, to have been given this beautiful organization which helps us as a means. It's like the boat. Of course, organization is not Swami. It is a boat that God gives us to cross the Bhavasagara. Yes, when the time comes, I have to kick the boat because I have crossed. But it would be foolish to kick the boat when I'm in the middle of the ocean. Let us cross and then kick away. Yes, correct. Organization is also an attachment. It is also a bandhan. But giving that dialogue on the first day when I come to attend Bal Vikas is stupidity. Because the boat is also not belonging to me, but I need the boat till I cross the ocean. So till we cross the ocean and reach our Swami, till we reach that state of Advaita, let us make use of this beautiful organization in all its ways. Karma, bhakti, jnana, let us plunge ourselves, because all the other things that we do will not give us what we can get from here. And once we get what we need to get from here, we will not want anything that the world has to offer for us. Thanking sir, thanking Swami, thanking everyone for this. I thank all of you for this beautiful opportunity, because I feel every time I speak, I'm the first listener and it reminds me. And therefore I thank Swami for all those who have this tremendous patience and love and they listen. And I just don't know what to say. Every time it is this experience of overwhelming love, because trust me or not, every time everyone looks, it almost feels like Swami is looking with joy. And that is where I look for my Swami nowadays, when my physical eyes are not able to see him sitting there. Thank you. Jai Sai Ram.